Happy Wednesday. Yeah, we made it halfway through the week. Piece of cake, right? Already, film scoring results are already in for River Runs Through It. Beautiful job, guys. We've really got the difference between finding that American sound, that intimate American sound. That's what we wanted. Because it's a very intimate scene between man versus nature, man versus fish. All those metaphors that I kind of understand, but, you know, sometimes I don't. And but really good job. So we'll see that on Friday. Tomorrow we're going to do LA. We have a lot of different things going on. We have way too much time and so little to do. I mean the opposite, actually. So as I promised, we're going to look at an American saxophonist, maybe one of the most famous tenor saxophone players that was so instrumental in bossa nova. His importance, as we're going to see, he brought bossa nova to America. So Stan Getz was really important for that, because once you get to America, the whole world knows you. It's just like the Beatles, and we'll talk about the Beatles in a little bit. They wanted to be number one in America before they even came to America, and that's why that famous scene of them coming into JFK, they were ready. They had come, they had arrived, and they were ready for all that fame bought. So a lot of this is good timing. So when you're, and then when America takes note, not that we're number one or the best, we are, though. We're a really great country, and despite a lot of other, you know, problems. Once our country takes notice of you, then you're really famous. So we're going to see how Stan Getz and Joe Beam, he took them, and they became this international sensation, rather. So let's take a look at the great saxophonist Stan Getz. So he's tenor. We've talked a lot about tenor saxophonists. We know that tenor is the lower saxophone range. Alto is higher, that's Charlie Parker. Soprano, John Coltrane plays a little soprano. Kenny G plays soprano, but those are in different worlds. Baritone's very low. Tenor's higher than baritone, but still at the low range of the sax. Have we talked about any tenor saxophone players? You bet your ass we have. We've talked a lot about John Coltrane. We did reviewed him. Getz isn't gonna sound like Coltrane, though. Okay, we talked about Johnny Griffin. Same instrument, doesn't sound anything like Johnny Griffin. Johnny Griffin's very abrasive, very, you know, like Lee Morgan, hard bop. This is not hard bop, this is cool jazz. We also looked at Ben Webster. Ben Webster's gonna be close to Stan Getz. Very breathy tone. And then we looked at Lester Young. Lester Young's probably the biggest influence Stan Getz has, is going to have. That's probably his biggest hero, Lester Young. And we did all of a class of Lester Young, how in the 30s people were playing with big bands, and then some bebop became faster, but then other people like Lester Young, Stan Getz a little bit later, because Lester's are going to be taking it slower, and Ben Webster. Not because they're not as technically fast. Same with Miles. Miles plays a little bit of bebop for a little bit, and he's like, no, I'm in a verge. So it's interesting to see how these genres are under the umbrella of jazz, but they're sub-genres, subcategories, and it's all about what's the best voice for you? Why be a second-rate Dizzy Gillespie when you can be a first-rate Miles Davis? Why be a second-rate John Coltrane when you can be a first-rate Stan Getz? So we're going to talk about how he gets that. So Stan Getz, born 1927, doesn't live long. Like most jazz guys, he had drugs and alcohol, got really into heroin. So dies at 64, so in Malibu. But from Pennsylvania, studies a bassoon and saxophone, and practices 8 hours a day. And got about 6 months of lessons and theory, but that was about it. After he got the basics, you know, geniuses sometimes just need a little bit of sometimes they need a lot of training. Sometimes they just need a little bit of teach me the fundamentals and then close the door and let me practice for, you know, for years and years and years. And that's, I think that's what Goetz did. So by 1943, he's 16. He goes in and plays with bands. Plays with Nat King Cole. We know Nat King Cole. Plays with Lionel Hampton. We did a whole class on Lionel Hampton. These guys were huge guys that had, especially Lionel Hampton, that had big bands. And a lot of soloists came out of these big bands. His idol, Lester Young, came out of Count Basie. We know that. So, you know, they have their own career. Also, Stan Kenton, Goetz plays with, who we haven't talked about, but one of the most famous band leaders, and we'll talk about Stan Kenton at some point. But then Goetz, with Charlie Bird, who's a guitarist, Charlie Bird's in because he goes to Brazil, because as we talked about, everything, Bossa Nova's from Brazil, and this all ties into yesterday's class, because it's Bossa Nova. Charlie Bird comes back, and I don't, you know, they have a conversation, they have a discussion. Somehow the two of them, he introduces Stan Goetz to Bossa Nova. And this is 1962. So this is, let's take a look at 1962, what's happening in American music, because this is America. Charlie Bird comes back, you know, Charlie Bird, great classical guitarist, jazz guitarist. And there's something about guitar and tenor saxophone, very good pairing, and we'll see that with João Gilberto and Stan Goetz. Something about tenor sax, the timbre of it is very smooth. There's something very, very nice about that. So, okay, 62, let's just get an idea, because culturally, context, we always need context. Beatles are turned down by Decca Records. So, as great as the Beatles are, they had failure. So whenever you guys feel failure, I feel failure, we all do, rejection, just know the Beatles were rejected. And I don't know if it was Decca, but it was somebody that told the Beatles, bands are going out, just so you know. So you might want to break up. Good thing they didn't listen to that. But then later, Love Me Do is released in 1962. Okay. Doesn't sound anything like Bossa Nova. Doesn't sound anything like jazz. But that's okay. We want to know what's going on in the same year that's not like this. Bob Dylan's coming out early. Early 60s is, Elvis is, of course, very famous. Frankie Valli, The Four Seasons are really at the top of the charts. So that's what's going on the year that Goetz is going to be like, maybe there's a new type of music that's similar to jazz, that's not quite going to be just cool jazz. Because cool jazz is, of course, right around, it's solidified by 1959 when Miles is kind of blue. Goetz also plays with Chet Baker, because Chet Baker, of course, is cool jazz, and they're West Coast people. So Goetz plays bebop, plays cool jazz, and then is influenced by Jobim and João Gilberto, who, of course, Jobim wrote Girl from Ipanema, and João plays guitar, and João's wife, Astrid. Here's a little clip of all of them playing, and, of course, take a listen to the saxophonist, because that is the one and only Stan Goetz. And young and lovely, the girl from Ipanema goes walking, and when she passes, he smiles, but she doesn't see. Gilberto and Jobim said that Goetz added a really great sound. They loved the collaboration. He said that he was, quote, an invisible partner in their creating the Bossa Nova sound with Goetz's jazz harmonies, these cool, delicate harmonies, melodies as he's soloing. Because as he plays the melody of Ipanema, we're just using that as a starting. He plays the melody, but he's also riffing off the melody and doing his own thing. But it is coming together sounding beautifully, right? So when they add and create Goetz Gilberto album, Gilberto, this makes them so, so famous. And the whole world has this new genre of music, jazz, samba, bossa nova. It's interesting when different countries kind of come together and say, well, you know, and different people, and I mean, you know, and they come together and then it just clicks and works. Especially with, you know, because, especially with jazz and bossa nova music, because, you know, jazz is America, New York, West Coast, and then Brazil is not even close to America. So it's interesting when these two things combine to make something sound so perfect and beautiful. So a little taste of Sam Getz. Just wanted to talk about his mellow tone, lush tone, a little like Lester Young, like Ben Webster, warm tone, lyrical tone. There's nothing more warm sounding, lyrical, very just great, lack of a better word, great background party music, because it's not too, you know, in your face or anything. It's just very, you know, it's whispering. Remember Ben Webster? Somebody said that it sounded like he was purring. Definitely Ben Webster was purring. Getz is purring a little bit with his, you know, this is just the cat analogy, with his instrument, but he's definitely, he's got a tone where you know exactly, oh, that's Stan Getz. And that's what we like. We like people that have a signature style, where when you hear Coltrane, that's Coltrane. When he's playing a ballad, when you hear Miles, that's Miles. When you hear Stan Getz, no doubt. And we always like people that take a different path and create their own space. I mean, that's what I like about with you guys. We always try to look at that. So that's the little Stan Getz. Love you guys. Miss you. I do. I miss the interaction, but I know, you know, always talk to me. I'm always here. And thanks for a great day. Okay. See you tomorrow. Bye.